There are a lot of stories written about the ATA in this book. Except one of the things that kept me sane in the lockdown. Okay, Air Transport Auxiliary. Air Transport is a British civilian organisation set up during the Second World War to ferry new, repaired and damaged military aircraft across throughout Britain, from delivery points, maintenance units, active service squadrons, and everywhere except aircraft carriers. I don't know why I said that, but it was a bit. They fondly call the ATA anything to anywhere. And that's what they did. That's exactly what they did. They were a few of them. Now, as you know, there are no safety harnesses, helmets. We can't put one person on a wing without needing a safety harness connected somewhere. But I don't think they were needed in those days. The initial plan of the ATA was to ferry aircraft with personnel, mail and medical supplies. So that was the original plan. However, as more and more serving pilots were taken to ferry aircraft, it became apparent that they needed some other method. So in May 1940, the ATA was taken over transporting all military aircraft from factories, units to have guns and radios to be installed. And then on the 1st of August 1940, they took over doing all ferry. No matter what it was, where it had to go, it was ferry. So this freed up the pilots for war, for the active combat duty. At one stage, there were 14 ferry pools around the UK. Whoops, one page too. So during that time, 343,430 people were transported without loss. There were a total of 174 pilots, men and women, who died carrying out their duties during this time. Initially, Geneva Convention was that all aircraft ferry had to be without guns, but owing to some encounters, they were then fitted with guns at the factory, and then they transported them. But I couldn't read anywhere there were any actual engagements on that. The ATA recruited pilots who were considered to be unsuitable for combat duties, like due to age, fitness or gender. And in fact, let me use the ladies, but there was quite a few ladies who carried out this task. And amongst them, some of the New Zealand girls did a sterling job. They would, in the morning, that they would ferry a Spitfire from the factory. In the afternoon, would pilot a B-17 to an American airfield, all by himself, single pilot operation. So there's this character here. He had one eye and one arm, but he still flew. He was capable of flying, probably in circles, but never mind. The unique feature of that all physical handicaps were ignored if the pilots could perform their duties. And there were 14 neutral countries they came from. Just this light shining on it a bit. In all, there are 28 countries. Total pilots, 1,152 men, 168 women. Total flying hours, get this, 415,000 during the course of the war. A total of 309,000 aircraft were ferried, and some of them were ferried transatlantic, all by themselves. Quite an amazing feat. And in all, 17 medals were issued in there, including one George medal, which you know is the Victoria Cross, 13 ODEs and 36 MBEs. Now, I couldn't find were there any Kiwi pilots in the ATA other than one. I'm assuming if they were fit Kiwis, they'd be flying for the RAF. There were five Kiwi women in the ATA. So prior to departing to the UK, three of the pilots, Trevor Hunter, yeah, that was her name, Eva Parkinson and June Somerville escorted Jean Batten around on her tour around New Zealand. Sadly, June Somerville died fearing a pilot from the a Spitfire from the factory and got airborne 600 feet, engine failed, and she spun in. And here's the famous lady here, Jean Batten. A lot of stories have been written about Jean Batten, so I don't need to embellish anything here.
What is she doing?
She's imagining every step of her flight, every takeoff, every landing, every landmark, rivers, mountains, lakes, every step along the way.
Set in contact.
Set contact.
You've got to be kidding, Jeans.
It's reckless.
For a woman.
Courageous for a man, though.
One end of the British Empire to the other. Capture the public's imagination like nothing before.
Civil aviation can't guarantee your safety.
Of course you can't. Well, nobody's been able to do that my whole life. It's an utterly ridiculous statement.
Jacqueline Cochran was an American who was ATA, and she then went to America and got the blessing of the president and formed a huge ferrying from B-17s to England. So there were 160 women pilots during the course of the war, and they had a very high profile with the English press. They just loved them. And they were called Atta Girls. That was one of their nicknames, because they had the ability to fly anything, so they were Atta Girls. Interesting, the women were paid the same as the men, which is the only example, I think, of England at the time. They were saying they paid the same rates. A South African woman, she was an ATA pilot, Jackie Muckeridge, but she was the very first woman in the world to have a status as an airline captain. And she was from South Africa. And she was a brilliant and a lot of flying for them. Now, Jackie Cochrane, as I was saying, she set up a similar organization in the US called the WASPs. Might have heard of that. 1,000 women to ferry US pilots from factories to squadrons and even heavy bomber across the UK. And once trained with all classes of aircraft, they could ask to ferry, and they even had even ones that had never flown before. And that was the same as the other lady. So what they would have flown, these aircraft they would have flown, they were not taught blind flying, so you never fly at night, it was all VFR. Because the objective was to deliver aircraft safely, so not by taking any risks. Often male bombers, bomber pilots, especially Lancaster pilots, Lancaster would arrive at its base, and then a slight woman would get out of the cockpit, and where's everyone else? No, it's just me. No, it's terrific. So These are the aircraft that they flew. So the Hawker Hurricane, that's Supermarine Spitfire, they had my Mosquito, Andy Page Halifax, Vickers Wellington, over Lancaster, Boeing B-17, and the Mustang, and strange enough, even the very Swordfish, but not out to carriers, as I said before. This was a little book they carried, the pilot's notes, and they doesn't know what aircraft, a page of that was devoted to how to start the aircraft and take off. Quite amazing, really. This is the, 50 years later, they had their reunion. This is the 50th reunion, and this particular lady here, Joy Lofthouse, when she was 90, she went for a flight.
Here we are, the Spitfire is behind you. You don't want me to ask you how you're feeling, do you?
Well, excited, but aware of my age, so hoping that things go okay. Not as confident as I did when I used to fly them alone when I was young.
What's so special about going in a Spitfire?
And it was the iconic plane. I know they both, Hurricanes and Spitfires, played their part. But the Spitfire lasted much longer because it's such a wonderful aeroplane, I think. The nearest thing to having wings of your own and flying that I've known. It's a beautiful day, couldn't be a better day. And I'm really, well, I'm being very cosseted, you know, being allowed to do it at all. And I'm very grateful.
Well, we'll let you get on.
Probably we've just got the Spitfire departing from 1-4. Okay, Joy, when you're ready, you have control.
It's incredible to be in a Spitfire again after so long. I'm so lucky to be given the chance to fly it every day. That's an iconic aircraft. Very hard to describe the feeling, but it almost makes one feel young again. This is always the exciting event, coming into land.
Absolutely.
Let's hope it's not too exciting.
Things will go all right.
Oh, I do hope so.
You won't bump too much.
Oh, from X-ray, River B5, taxi hold 14 left, left-hand circuit, QNH1033.
I didn't talk as much as I'd hoped because, of course, someone was talking all the time. That's something I was not used to. We had no radio, and once you took off, it was complete silence. And that was the big difference today. There was someone talking all the time, and I was afraid that when I talked, I might be interfering with what the pilot needed to hear. But it was lovely. It was perfect, of course. It made me feel quite young.
Here's a story now, just a quick story regarding the ATA and how they work.
Smoke trails which we used to see over southern England have now moved to northern France. But to keep the Royal Air Force on the offensive, Hundreds of aircraft must be flown each day between the factories, the maintenance depots and the aerodromes. The RAF can't take on the job. They're too busy on active service. It's done for them by the ATA, Air Transport Auxiliary, a civilian air force of men and women operating from their own pools or stations scattered all over Britain. First thing every morning, the central control transmits to each of the ferry pools its schedule of aircraft to be flown from maintenance depots to operational aerodromes.
Whitley, V9703. You got that? Walbrook to Park Gate. That seems to be all for you today. Just read me back the last lot, will you?
All right, here we go. Tomahawk, P3384, Helensburgh. Master, N7623, Hazelwick, Little Brompton. Over. Hurricane R3201, Massingham, Edinburgh. Spitfire R3430, Lumington, Walbrook. Spitfire R4921, Lumington, Walbrook. Whitley V7903, Walbrook, Park Gate. And the weather?
Hang on, I'll have a look.
Light wind, damn cold, visibility nil. Otherwise, ideal flying weather.
Lord. Fred's a bit thick here. The wind coming up, so we might get a reasonably early start.
Right. Goodbye. It'll have to clear up for this lot, by George. They're turning out like sausages, aren't they?
Yes, sir. It's a hell of a big program.
Yeah. Heard from the factories, yeah?
Yes, not yet.
Well, that's closer to calm, I suppose.
Yes.
Got any signals from the pilots?
Yes, bundle here.
Thanks.
This morning, as always, the CO of 15 ferry pools faced with a tough proposition. He has to arrange for his 50 pilots to ferry some hundreds of aircraft between aerodromes scattered all over the British Isles. And here are his pilots, some of the most versatile to be found anywhere. Many of them can fly any one of 80 different types of aircraft. They come not only from Britain and the Commonwealth, but from all over the world. They come also from every type of job. Salesman, schoolmaster, scientist, advertising agent, stunt pilot, test pilot, doctor, dramatic critic. In peacetime, they flew their puss moths for a hobby. Today, it's anything from Spitfires to four-engine bombers. And now the CO is faced with another headache, the ferrying of his pilots. A special fleet of Ansons and civilian types of aircraft is used to carry on this aerial bus service. All day long, these taxi planes shuffle to and fro, dropping pilots at the factory up north, chasing down south to pick up others, and dropping them at an aerodrome in the Midlands. Headache number three, demands from the local factories for new aircraft to be collected.
Here we go.
Yeah. See you, Ferry Pool. Good morning. What can we do for you today? Two Blenheims, that all? Ashington to Roxburgh.
Both? Ashington to Roxburgh, hang on. Thanks.
Hello, do you say Ashington to Roxburgh? Good, that's the first time you've been useful in months. We'll be over there about noon. Is that okay? Thank you. That's good. Get some Mollison and Glass there to France and
yes.
Set us a taxi.
Right.
Take this out. The pilots will do all the things.
Hello, 15 ferry pool here. Four hurricanes. All to Bradhurst. Hang on a minute. How do we cope, sir?
I think the best thing is to send one pilot over in his own puss moth. We'll do the whole lot, shuttling to and fro.
Right.
I'll send the unfortunate Jones.
We'll send a pilot over, so if you can have them ready one by one, starting about an hour's time, be fine. Right? Goodbye.
Well, that fixes the hurricane.
Oh, dear. Hello, yes? Yes? May I leave Farnham? Yes, hold it, will you?
What now? Farnham wants to move 25 Tiger Moths to Leighton.
Hold it to me, will you? Hello? I'm sorry, but tigers are rather a drug in the market today. The fighter boy is being awfully insistent on getting their hurricanes. But it's just the sort of thing the training pool might cope with. Hang on, will you?
Put it over there, will you?
Thanks.
Give this call to training pool, will you? Thank you.
Now, touching this little matter of Thompson and Talbot, we've got them to Walbrook in their Spitfires. What happens then?
The Whitley's there.
Oh, yes. Is Thompson all right on the heavy stuff?
Yes, sir. He's held a basin full of bread and sent to Wellington, too.
Right. Then we'll put him on his first Whitley.
Good morning, Tommy.
Morning, Talbot.
What do you know about this run up to Walbrook? I hear you going up that way.
Why, yes. In the first place, you have a gun-defended area here. You're going across it. You're supposed to miss it. And you're driving straight into a balloon barrage.
It comes around something like this.
What the hell had to put them on our track there for?
Not on mine. I don't argue with balloons.
Well, we can always go around it.
God help you if you don't.
Rather embarrassing.
By the way, I believe you're riding with me in the Whitley.
Yeah, from Warbrook to Park Gate. Where's Park Gate? The aerodrome's around here as thick as fleas on a dog's back.
Up north of Newcastle.
Double 972's outside, huh?
Good, we'll get going then. Hello, hello. Attention, please.
Attention, please. Anson, 972, pilot Douglas, waiting outside for Thompson, Talbot, Mollison, Carter, Smith, and Felton.
That's me. Still your move?
Yeah, let's shut the trouble.
Attention, please. Pilots Stewart, Keynes, and Stevens. Anson, N5100. Anson, R4259. P2936.
Pilot's day starts easily enough. There's the view to admire, no traffic blocks, and these taxi planes have no meters ticking away. But the work that lies ahead isn't easy. Every day they're flying different aircraft, and no matter what the type, they must be able to remember its peculiarities. The difference between the Spitfire and the Tomahawk, the Blenheim and the Bowfighter, the Stirling and the Liberator. It's not pleasant to take over an aircraft you've never met before, to know that it's up to you to deliver the machine and yourself all in one piece. Here's another pool, staffed entirely by women pilots. Some of the most experienced are ferrying Spitfires, Hurricanes and Lysanders, but mostly they deliver training planes. These training planes, by the way, require just as much skill to fly as the fastest fighters. In fact, once in the air, these girls face the same hazards as the men. Balloons, bad weather conditions, the difficulties of navigation without radio. And when it comes to that, there's always the chance of a stray jerry popping out from behind the next cloud. Here's Anson 9972 calling in at a Spitfire factory in the Midlands. Thompson and Talbot are being dropped to pick up their first jobs.
I suppose you know where the balloons are.
Well, we did up till yesterday.
So long as they put no new ones up.
Good, that's fine. Would you sign here?
Right. Hello. Is this a private party or may we come in?
Hello, boy. Come right in.
Morning, girls. Do you know Talbot, better known as Alabama?
Hello.
I do.
Two Spitfires, please.
There it is.
What are you taking today, Betty?
Trainers at the old master's, Dad. Yes, 200 miles an hour is our limit, I'm afraid.
Alabama, here comes Alex. This ought to be worth watching.
Who is Alex?
The factory test pilot. He knows how.
Oh, he's a Spitfire test pilot, huh?
Thank you.
That boy sure can't handle a plane. Here he comes back again. We heard quite a bit about Spitfires in the States. I didn't know they'd have a performance like that. I paid quite a bit price to see good air shows, but this takes the cake. He really knows his stuff.
We're not into the Schneider Trophy, you know.
Okay, I'll keep a tight harness on it.
See you at Walbrook.
Okay.
I wished I wasn't following Tommy. I sure would ring this one out. Kind of hard to make out with just mail. Can't use radio. That'd give Jerry a line on us. This place is wrapped up in towns and railroads. Back home in Alabama, we get one town, couple hundred miles of corn and cotton, then maybe a man and a horse. A fella can fly without fear of running out of land anyway.
I might stop here because it carries on a fair bit with some of that, but you get the gist there, don't you? So that's about it. I have a short presentation. That was the last